the Simple Steps Personal Finance Podcast, bringing personal finance to you step by step. This is episode 11. Thanks for joining me. Before we start, let me just remind you that my Christmas offer is still in force. My starter package cost has been reduced by 20%. That's three 90-minute coaching sessions with two bonus 45-minute catch-ups for a one-off cost of only £200. The coaching sessions can be performed over Skype or FaceTime, making them as convenient for you as possible. By organising your finances and improving your relationship with money, coaching pays for itself. You can gift the package to someone you feel could benefit from personal coaching. A single friend, a sibling and their partner, your parents, or your adult child. It's never too early or too late to take control of your finances. Non-judgmental and supportive guidance to making the most of this financial world. In this episode, I want to give you food for thought as we enter another year, with fresh intentions to tidy up and improve our finances. The passing into this new year also reminds us that things don't stay the same and change is a fact of life. With that in mind, I'm going to take advantage of your New Year's desire to tidy up your finances, and I want to raise the rather prickly subject of death with you. Or more to the point, what would happen in the aftermath of a loved one's passing? I'll do my best to keep this from being a morbid issue. In fact, let's both agree to something. Wanting to make sure those you may leave behind are cared for financially is a wonderful tribute to life, not death. So we will talk of these things in a positive light. Now, the breadwinner in a family has become harder and harder to define over the last few decades. In the 60s and 70s, the father would work and earn, the mother would raise the children. In the decades that have followed, women are now an integral part of the workforce, able to aspire to the same careers as their male counterparts. It's an entirely different topic if we wish to discuss the reality of true equalities, and I'm not looking to tread on that ground. What we can all agree on, though, is the role of breadwinner is often shared between both partners in a relationship nowadays. The income is no longer one-sided. The benefits can be seen by the huge standard of living increase we've witnessed in that time. All those TVs, cars, home comforts, even computers and gadgets, these are bought with the opportunity two income households open up. Again, the credit boom of the 90s and the invention of the home computer muddy that short definition of mine, but the extra money coming into households has reduced the burden on only one parent earning. Or at least, that's what the theory would have you believe. The truth of the modern household is much the same as it always was. Whatever money comes in gets spent. The only thing that's changed is the definition of necessity. Necessary used to be food, heating, basic clothing, basic provisions with few mod cons to choose from. Nowadays, there is a seemingly infinite way to spend money. The second income coming into the house has been all but swallowed up by the burgeoning consumer goods industry. In simple terms, we might earn more, but life got even more expensive. Add in the credit card frenzy of the 1990s and early 2000s, the bubble burst of 2008, and the subsequent stagnation of incomes, and you can see how runaway spending came to a brutal halt. Many households up and down the social ladder felt the pain in some way. Incomes found new pressures, and suddenly we felt vulnerable. And it's this vulnerability that I want to address now. Let me ask you a question. If you were no longer around and your income stopped coming into the household, would everyone be able to survive on? It's a tough question, I know, but try to strip any emotion out of the question itself and just look at the figures on your spending plan. If your income stopped, could the household continue on uninterrupted? Chances are the answer here is a financial no, or certainly not without having a major lifestyle adjustment. And that would be an entirely natural response by many households around the country. The first 10 episodes that I've brought you through the Simple Steps Personal Finance Podcast have been centered on improving your day-to-day living by living by a deliberate monthly spending plan and attacking short-term debt. We ensure that you're able to live on what you earn and have some left over to clear debt. Then that money could be used to put together a rainy day fund for times when you need a financial umbrella. We then look to start putting money away for the long term. Why? Because the longer our window of time, the better return we can expect to get on any money invested. Compound interest and performance being our allies over generous time horizons. From a logic point of view, it makes sense to make sure that living needs are covered before moving on to anything fancy. If you were building a house, you'd put in foundations first, wouldn't you? Well, this is the financial version of that. In the world of financial advice, once your living needs are covered, the next step up the ladder is protection. Not getting a burglar alarm or a dog, financial protection. What would happen if the household suffered a death or a serious illness? At a time where the emotional impact will be, as you'd expect, huge, would the financial fallout make things even worse? Let me paint a bleak picture. The higher earning parent of the house unexpectedly passes away, leaving two young children and a wife. Without his income, would she be able to continue to pay the bills as normal? In his absence, would she need to hire outside help for minding the children while she continues to work? Would she run through any savings trying to keep the children's lives as stable as possible so they didn't have any further upheaval, but then exhaust all savings and have to move home anyway? What if it were her that passed away instead? Would the father be able to cover the bills? Would he need outside help with raising the kids and running the home? Would he be able to continue in the same line of work, being a single parent? A lot of issues would come to light directly after the death. It can be something of a 1-2 punch, as they say in boxing. The second heavy blow is the realization that the family finances are unable to cope with the change, and that lifestyle will have to change to accommodate a lower income. That means a likely change of house, downsized, and even a change of schools or jobs because of location. I told you, the picture can be bleak. It's hardly unexpected when looking through the lens of money, not emotion. If you spend everything you earn, then how could you do the same with half the money? Of course you can't. So to avoid the two of this 1-2 punch, we enter the world of financial protection. We look for solutions to separate financial impact from the emotional impact of a sudden loss. So what options are there for providing financial insurance? I mean, it is insurance that we're looking at here. That's what it sounds like. Like car insurance pays out in the event of an accident, there is life insurance that pays out in the event of death. Life insurance, a policy that pays out an agreed amount should you die during the lifetime of the policy. In much the same way a car insurance policy pays out if you have an accident during that year, well, life insurance is bought for much longer, say 15 years to 25 or 30 years. Now it makes sense that the longer you need it for, the more expensive it is. If you die during that time period, then the insurance company writes a big check to your estate or your beneficiary, likely your partner, or put into a trust for your kids. Now there's some vocab in there that you might not be familiar with, like estate and trust. For what is quite a rare occurrence for me, I'm not going to go into depth and describe these meanings for you right now. I'll be doing an episode on leaving things upon death and the inevitable inheritance tax you have to consider at a later date. At that point, I'll go into detail about this new lingo. For now though, let's just take it as a given that the proceeds of a life insurance policy will be paid out to your partner. Picture this situation then. A young couple get married. They're both in their early 30s when the first baby arrives. Another arrives a couple of years later. Over the next decade, the kids grow up. Both parents work solidly, and then university starts to creep up. Both kids, now young adults, graduate and start their careers. Mum and dad continue to work, paying off the house and then retiring to a low-maintenance home nearer to the kids and the impending grandchildren. Travelling a few times a year too. Sounds like quite a normal progression, right? Right. So at what point was life insurance necessary for this couple? As a young married couple, were one or the other to pass away unexpectedly, there may be great heartache, but the financial loss might be relatively limited. If they're renting a home together when the death occurs, the remaining partner can relocate to a more affordable property to put the pieces back together. If they had a mortgage together, then it might have been an idea to leave some money to pay off that. Once the children start to arrive, the need for stability becomes paramount. The children come first, And as any parent would attest, keeping their lives stable and comfortable is their number one wish. Maternity leave and a period looking after the children before schooling starts means that income reduces and the dependence on the money that is being earned increases. From this point on, the loss of one of those young parents will be catastrophic to the standard of living, as well as the pressure that will be put on the financial circumstances of the family. So taking out life insurance at this point, with a duration of 20 or more years, would make sense. A sum of money that would replace the income they bring into the household, and for a length of time that covers their financial vulnerability. From toddler to young, educated, independent adult. Once the kids are grown and have flown the nest, the financial ties are optional and no longer necessary. Should one of the parents pass at this point, it might be nice to leave a nest egg to the children, but it wouldn't be essential for them, as they can make their own way in life. And what about the partner? Well, it'd be reasonable to expect that other wealth has been growing in the background over that couple of decades. The mortgage has been paying down, if not fully paid off completely. Were they a Simple Steps couple, then there'd be 15% contributions for their old age over all those years. This may well prove enough of a nest egg that a further injection from life insurance would be unnecessary. As they near retirement and enter retirement, the money used to fund that would be enough to survive each of their passings, else it wouldn't have been enough to retire on in the first place. There may even be some that can be left to the children and now grandchildren. So that's a very long-winded way of saying this short, simple rule. If you have people depending on you for the finances you bring into the household, then you need life insurance. The amount they depend on you, or the amount you bring in, determines the amount of life insurance you should look to put in place. The length of time you expect them to depend on you determines the window of time you wish the insurance to cover. Now that simpler way of thinking, I think that's a bit easier to work with. On to our next big question then. If we're happy with the reasoning as to why we should have life insurance, then how much of it do we need? There are a couple of ways of estimating an acceptable amount. Before I enter into them, remember this though. The amount will never be exactly right. But whatever is left behind for your loved ones is much, much better than leaving nothing at all. Another thing I would say is to not worry about the cost of this insurance just yet. Let's be honest with our calculations, and then we'll look at the cost of it afterwards. So what's our first method? Take the amount of money that is needed by the household in your absence, and multiply it by the time it will be needed for. For instance, let's say your salary was £30,000 each year, and you contribute £20,000 after deductions into the household, and the children are very young, so this will be needed for the next 21 years, until they're out of education. £20,000 times 21 years gives us £420,000. This money could be kept in an account, and £20,000 drawn out every year as if your salary was still coming into the household. What's our second method? This involves taking your annual salary and multiplying it by 10. So let's say the salary was, again, £30,000 each year. Multiply that by 10 and we get £300,000. The idea then is to invest this money in a way that it returns 5%. That's better than cash interest rates, but less than the riskier stock market. In a later episode, I'll talk about investing in the two-bucket method to achieve this type of return. But for now, back to the lump sum of £300,000 earning 5% each year. So that's interest of £15,000. Now the reality of earning £30,000 a year means that some is taken for tax and national insurance, but then there's the expenses of travelling to work, paying into the company pension, taking money out for long-term savings, having to buy work clothes. You can see where I'm going here. The actual amount of money that you bring into the house after these associated costs have been accounted for is much less than your actual net pay. So if the real figure you put into the household is lower than expected, then perhaps £15,000 each year really is the right amount to mimic your contribution to the household. So two methods, two different amounts, £420,000 versus £300,000. So how does this help us? Well, we have a ballpark to aim at. Also, we could sit down with our spending plan and create a best guess estimate of what our costs would be if suddenly our partner was no longer here. We could estimate additional childcare costs, perhaps even the costs associated with living in a different area, returning closer to one side of the family. Once this alternate plan has been fleshed out, you could look at the required amount of income needed to make that happen and base your lump sum amount off of that. In other words, we could use the first method. Now, this would work by giving you an amount of money for a certain length of time. We'd assess the amount needed and multiply that by the number of years. We could then invest that amount in a way to guarantee a touch of interest as we slowly dipped into the fund for our annual needs. It's worth saying that neither method is better or worse for all instances. If you performed either, then you'd have a lot of money left behind after you pass, and the family would not go hungry ever, regardless of the method used. For instances where the family might live a completely different life if one parent passed away, say your other half's relatives are far away, then assessing the amount needed based on an alternate spending plan would be best. The costs may be much different for that other life than the one you actually live now. If the family are settled though and the life they lead would stay the same after you have passed, then the 10 times method would replace your financial contribution adequately. In both instances, the money that is paid out from life insurance should be looked after in a way that the lump sum pays out interest each year. Now, this interest could make up the majority or all of the money needed to be drawn out of it each year. But by doing this, the amount would stay intact and could be gifted to children and grandchildren upon your partner's later death. A way of putting wealth into the family tree. If the amount you need to take out turns out to be higher than expected, then the interest on the lump sum should extend the time frame of the withdrawals, slowing down the time it's going to take to hit zero. Either way, leaving a lump sum gives your remaining relatives options, and warding off the financial blow that so often follows emotional turmoil is a huge gift to them. Now, the last topic I have to cover before we wrap up this episode is cost. Well, like any insurance, the cost is different for each set of circumstances. The type of life insurance we've been talking about here was level term life insurance. Level, because we stated a lump sum amount to be paid on death. Term, because we stated how long the policy should last. So in our example, level term of £300,000 for 21 years. Level term is quite a cheap life insurance. It becomes expensive if the end of your term starts to get close to your likely age of death. Statistics exist that can predict the likely age of death for people of your age, your health, and your lifestyle. These actuarial charts are used to see the likelihood of your dying within the window of time you want insurance for, and then your policy is priced accordingly. So a 30-year-old looking for 20 years of level term life insurance would have a low expectancy to die before the age of 50 when the policy runs out. However, someone aged 45 looking for a 25-year level term policy would have a much higher chance of dying by age 70 when that policy would run out. So the cost of that would be much, much higher. The easy way to think of it, the younger you are, the cheaper the policy will be. The best way to think about it then is to get this type of policy as soon as your circumstances require it. If you have a baby, then you should apply for life insurance immediately and go make a will too, so your wishes for life after you can be noted. Now, one word of warning, there are types of life insurance that combine this lump sum protection with an investment, often called whole of life life insurance. The premiums are much higher than standard term insurance, and the investment attached is usually very costly with poor performance. So best to steer clear. In fact, whenever a product tries to do too many things, it's usually a bad idea. So keep products simple. Doing one job well enough is more than enough for our expectations. Now, just a little example of level term life insurance costs. This is merely to give you an idea of the cost, not any specific accuracy for your exact circumstances. So we're just going to use an example £300,000 policy over 21 years. Now, a 30-year-old non-smoker in good health would pay just £11.50 per month. If they were a smoker, this goes up to £18 per month. A 40-year-old non-smoker would look to pay £22 each month. But if this 40-year-old was a smoker, it rises to £44 each month. So you can see the earlier the policy is needed, and the better the health of the person, the lower the cost of the policy. From my perspective, though, these policies are not expensive when you consider the potential amount that can be paid out. 300 grand of protection from as little as £3,000 to £11,000 spent over 21 years for the examples I've just given. If you outlive the policy and no money is ever received, it's no different to having car insurance and not having an accident that year. You'd be happy to come out the other side, right? Being without insurance just seems way too expensive a mistake. Now let me close this off with some little additions. There are several types of life insurance available. We talked here about level term, a set amount over a set time period. If that amount needed to increase over the years, there's a policy called increasing level term insurance, where the amount is increased by a set percentage each year. It might be 300,000 this year, 302 next, 305 the year after, then 308 and so on. There's also decreasing level, where the amount is reduced over the life of the policy. Now you might want to increase the amount each year if your salaries, and by extension your lifestyle costs, are rising every year. You might want to decrease the amount each year if your major cost, let's say your mortgage, is reducing every year, as that amount of income wouldn't be needed in the future. You could mix and match, have a decreasing level term policy to cover the mortgage, and an increasing level term policy to cover your lifestyle costs. Or you could round them off together and opt for a single level term policy, as our examples outlined earlier. The important thing is to understand the different types of term life insurance and see how they can work for you. The amount of choice shouldn't put you off taking out such an important policy. Make it as complicated or as simple as you can handle. After all, I know we're talking about death here, and people's tolerance for discussing mortality is low at the best of times, so I do want to wrap this up now. But let me have one final thought. You have a policy to pay your partner should you pass. Your partner has a policy to pay you should they pass. No joint policies, as that's just complicated. The amounts may be different because your incomes may be different. Life after one of you passes will be different to each of you. And where does this fit on our simple steps framework? Well, these policies are necessary costs when the policies themselves are necessary. So simple step one. They belong on the spending plan, regardless of your debt level or your savings level. Death doesn't respect your finances, but we need to respect our families enough that a death doesn't ruin all lives. Emotions will adjust over time, but money either comes or goes. So let's make sure it stays. Next time, I want to continue on this theme of protection and insurance. So we'll be looking at protecting our income from illness or the inability to work. After all, being unable to work is a double-edged sword. The cost of living as well as having no income. In the meantime though, check out my blog at sspf.co.uk/blog for more financial common sense. Don't forget to spread the word. Financial peace of mind is here to stay. Simple Steps and my personal finance coaching are here to help. If you're finding this approach useful but are unsure on how to act, drop me a line. Let's see how personal finance coaching can help you. After all, what could be better than having personal guidance tailored to your circumstances? And take advantage of my Christmas discount now at sspf.co.uk/book. I can always be reached on my email, that's chris@sspf.co.uk. Thanks for listening, that's it for episode 11. For more information, check out sspf.co.uk for show notes and transcripts for each episode. This podcast is copyright of Simple Steps Personal Finance and can be shared freely. The SSPF podcast is available as direct download on Android, RSS, iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, Vimeo, Dailymotion, and more. We're here however you want us. If you like what you're hearing, please leave a review so others know to listen in too. Thanks, as always, to Partners in Rhyme for the music used throughout this episode. See you next time.